Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. And on this edition, I am joined by another new face in Scottish pro wrestling. It is Robbie Cardwell. Welcome to the show.
Hi, Billy. Thanks for having me. Hello, everyone.
Thanks for being on. I'm really excited for this because my first like exposure to you, I suppose, was just when Respect were putting up some showcase matches. And as soon as I saw yourself, I was like, yeah, I probably need to speak to him at some point when he makes his in-ring debut. And here we are. And I thought there was no better time to grab you as soon as your match with Martin Kirby popped up. Like, yep, I know when I need to get a hold of a Robbie for a podcast. And here we are.
And
hopefully going to have a good chat about it. So I've got loads of questions in through the Twitter and through Instagram, through your Instagram as well. So we'll get onto them at some point. But the first question is always the same. It's the cliched wrestling podcast question. It's how did you get into pro wrestling? So what was the moment that you were watching it or exposed to it and that got you hooked on pro wrestling?
So very first memory I have of pro wrestling is Money in the Bank 2012. Very first show I watched, it was like 3 on Sky Sports or something, and my gran had it. And I think my friends had talked to me about it at school, and I watched that, and I've been hooked ever since.
So I've got Money Bank 2011 in my head, but obviously it wasn't that one. So we've got 2012 offering. Is that when? Is that Cena winning the Money in the Bank?
Yeah, year? I know everyone's like the Cena Punk match. I was like Cena winning the briefcase.
It's we've got pretty interesting. We've got Dolph Ziggler winning the. So your first match you would have seen in pro wrestling at that point would have been a match involving Santino Marella, Sin Cara, and Tenzai.
Yes, that was my very first taste of pro wrestling.
And you decided to stick with it.
I did. And then I ended up seeing like the Big Show versus Kofi Kingston in a steel cage the next week, and I was absolutely hooked.
Amazing. So who are your favourites then when you started off in 2012, making me feel so old at this point, but anyway, as all these youngins do. But who are your favorites then? Who was your boys?
It was all like the big faces because I was just a kid, so it was like Cena, Punk, Kingston, Sin Cara, Randy Orton. That was like the 5 top childhood favorites.
So you're the one Sin Cara fan that got here.
It was me. I was the one that told folk he really can jump that high. There's no trampoline. He could make that jump. My internet connection apparently is unstable.
All right, okay. That's fine. So we're speaking about Sin Cara. Said you could really jump high in the trampoline. That's fine. Right, okay. So
Sin Cara, he botches wrestling. He's botching the internet. Like, he's come back to haunt me.
That's fine. That seems to be cutting this whole little bit out then. We've recovered it. Damn you, Sin Cara, and your botchiness. I did ask though. Were you one of the ones that had the T-shirt that looked a bit dodgy?
I never got the T-shirts. No, that was like it was. I got figures and stuff, but T-shirts never.
When you started doing the wrestling or going to wrestling shows, then you saw the masks. Sin Cara one would have been the one that was like yes, because. I mean, Rey Mysterio wasn't even wrestling in WWE at that point, so you wouldn't even been aware of him entirely.
I knew who he was because I'd played like the games and stuff as well, and he was in them. But at the shows, like Sin Cara masks were more expensive, and my mum went, "Well, you can get the £10 Rey Mysterio one rather than £15 Sin Cara one."
It was the right choice. Your mum made the right choice at the end of the day when it came to that. But
it was the right choice. We picked the right. She picked the right luchador.
So how'd you go from that? So you're watching it. You're watching it on telly. You saw the amazingness that is Sin Cara, who's getting all the plugs in this particular episode. How did you go from that then to did you discover Scottish wrestling shows, local shows to you at that point, or was there, or was just you grew up and thought I want to try this, and there was a school locally? How did you end up getting thrusted into Scottish wrestling?
My first kind of exposure to Scottish wrestling would have been the ICW documentaries on BBC. I think that was one, probably wasn't age appropriate to be watching those as well. So those ones like, oh, there's a wrestling documentary on Robbie, I like that. And I was sitting watching that, and that's how I kind of started to know the names like Jack Jester and Grado and all your kind of Scottish icons are still about these days. That's kind of there. And then actually training, I had a friend who trained at PBW Academy. I think they ran like a free kind of 4-week trial thing. And I went and tried that, and I've been doing it for wrestling 3 years now in different schools.
So you said you were possibly too young to watch that. So the ICW documentary, the first one came out like 2014. So how old were you at that point?
I would have been 10.
Yeah, you're definitely too young to watch
that. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
I would have been 10 when that came out.
Wow. All right. So at that point you would have seen Grado, of course, who that's fine. That's in the age range. And then of course then Jack Jester, who definitely was not, and it's certainly nice to have you.
Absolutely not.
So your friend was involved with, well, he was training at PBW and you went along as well. So did you, outside of, I'm assuming because you're 10 years old, you were playing football and all that kind of stuff, but was there any other? No, I wasn't
a football kid. I loved video games. I would rather like sit home and play my Xbox, or like I'd go out and like climb a tree or fall out something. That probably explains my love for the going up in the top rope, like falling out of high trees and stuff.
That's fair. I mean, yeah, you've got that death-defying risk-taking style, and that's how you did it instead. That's fine. So yeah, so coming into training then, that 4-week trial, you didn't have a sport background, didn't have something to fall back on, or like, yeah, something to build a foundation. You were just thrust in the deep end, to speak. So how did you find that first couple sessions?
Oh, it was so nerve-wracking. Because I'd loved wrestling, it was one of those ones where I was like, if I go to this and I'm not that like great at it, I'll be heartbroken, because it's like something I love to watch and it's always something I wanted to try and now make a career out of. I was 15 when I started, so I was like, right, well, hopefully I can get into this. But I kind of went, and I'd done like a wee bit of gymnastics when I was younger. Really, really young, and some of that kind of stuff, like doing rolls and stuff, transitioned over, and natural kind of athleticism kind of helped build. So it was quite good. I think I handled myself.
So I'm 15 years old then, they've watched wrestling for a few years. They come into PBW, which is of course mats. It's not a ring. Was their initial like going, oh no, I've come into the wrong wrestling here. This isn't what I'm here for. Yeah. I'm here for the top rope and ladders and chairs. Where's that stuff?
Yeah, I kind of walked in and I was like, where's the ring? And then they're like, oh, we train on mats and stuff. Rings are only for like shows and all that. And I was like, oh, okay. It was quite different as to what I expected. I was expecting to walk into some like hall and there'd be like a ring in the middle, and there would be folk kicking about in like their tights and stuff, and like their spandex or like whatever. I wear jeans. I don't really know what these guys have their stuff made out of. But no, it was just different. But it was a good. I think it was a good different. It was, you know, it kind of really makes you appreciate actually wrestling in a ring.
How long was it before you actually got into a ring? Was it quite quickly, or were you?
No, it wasn't until I started training at GPWA that I got into a ring. So I did.
How long was that then?
For a year, at least a year and a half. I had done. It was like March 2019, right up until the first pandemic, I was with PBW. And then over lockdown, ICW were offering one-to-ones. And I went up and started trying them. And that was my first actual taste of like rolling about and running the ropes inside a ring.
So we'll get into like pandemic stuff and all that kind of thing, and how you filled your time. Because, yeah, we started wrestling then, of course. Yeah, mats, no ring, but no ring time in itself, because you never actually got there. Were you also taking training at Respect? I noticed your name pop up in Respect as well. Was that just a kind of side hustle you had going on at the same time? Like, did GPWA one-to-ones before you went full-time or with them, or did you do Respect just to supplement?
I tried my best to balance both. So over like the lockdowns and pandemics, when there wasn't really training schools, like it was all just one-to-ones, I was down at GPWA But then as like we kicked into the summer of, I think it was last summer, and everything kind of started to open up, I went down to a trial weekend at Respect. And it was since last summer, I've just kind of juggled between GPWA classes, one-to-ones, and going down to Respect and training.
And then, of course, as of Respect closed as of recording like last weekend, so they've just closed up their doors for the time being or the foreseeable. Who knows? Never say never in wrestling. I suppose you can never say that they'll be gone forever. But at the moment, it looks like that's them wrapped up. So get into the ring then for the first time, brand new experience. You've been wrestling for a year and a half at this point, and then the big break in between. And what was it like? I hear the ropes are the one of the worst things when it comes to wrestling. How did you find those?
They were like, now they're fine, but I was going home with like welts, like three sets of welts on my back from where the ropes had been. So it'd be like shoulder blades, kind of middle of the back, and then my bum, where like I'd been hitting the ropes. That's pretty much how it was. It's just these big, almost like seeing your eyes go blood shot. It's like that. And I'd like bruises as well. Oh, right.
So for a moment, you missed the mats. It came to down to it.
It's gone off again. I once, and here I just crashed in. Oh, I'm back.
You're back. Yeah. So you're missing the mats for a moment then, is when once you had a couple sessions on the ropes.
No, absolutely not. Mats, it's like, not to take away from mat training, I think it is still really good. It like opens up a lot of new kind of styles and ways to wrestle, but actually get yourself really show ready. I think there's no better way to train in the ring, because it allows to show for like ring positioning and ring awareness and where you are, and it gives you a really good way to get your kind of your bearings and your surroundings. If that makes sense.
I mean, we just saw this past a couple of weekends ago, if that, WWE, their house show, their UK loop, and of course, Bobby Lashley, I think it was Drew as well, had a match in the top rope, broke.
I've seen that, and Lashley just tumbled to the outside.
Yeah, so, I mean, even the professionals, they would have to work around that and work with the ring with the ropes. I mean, these two guys probably don't often need to use the ropes, I suppose, because they're humongous and they're mostly power-based, but still, it's still a skill that's worthy to have, and you probably need to have just in case of that eventuality as well. So when you started training, was there anyone in particular that you watched trying to maybe try and pick up and mold your style after, whether it was on TV or at these local shows or trainers that you had? Was there anyone that you tried to kind of lift things from to put together in your puzzle?
When I started training, it was I loved NXT. That was black and gold NXT was always the style I knew I wanted to wrestle. That kind of like high, I don't know, what was it, like spot fest, like kind of the indie kind of more style. Everything's quite fast, quite flashy. That's kind of the way I wanted to wrestle. So I was influenced guys like Balor, Owens, Zayn, Joe, kind of that class at NXT was where I thought, right, this is how I want to wrestle.
So high risk, possibly high reward kind of thing going on there.
Yeah.
Okay. So, I mean, I suppose when you came in at the time in 2012, then, like say, Kofi Kingston, you mentioned, he was probably doing that kind of style on the main roster as well. He was throwing himself all over the place for us to enjoy. And then, of course, you had likes of CM Punk and Daniel Bryan doing the same kind of indie style, but grounded and all that kind of stuff. So there's a little bit of everything when you're starting, and then of course you moved into NXT. So you mentioned Balor, Joe, and what have you, and Owens. That was kind of an interesting choice, because he seemed like a polar opposite of what you were going for, but he does have that kind of big senton, big kind of throwing himself.
Well, his stuff is Kevin Steen. It's all quite like high impact. So like you say, his sentons, his kind of moonsaults he was doing, his package pile drivers. It's a lot of stuff that, like, if you're going to hit that is your big move, and don't want somebody to kick out of that. It's a really high kind of reward move.
So when you saw these guys and, like, your Balors and what have you, and you mentioned Kevin Steen, So did you go back and go, right, where did this guy come from? And then you looked up Ring of Honor. Oh, I'm going to see the bits and pieces here. And was it just through YouTube? Was that kind of your haven for all this kind of stuff? Or were you able to nab DVDs or anything like that when you were trying to look for this stuff?
It was mostly YouTube. So going back, I seen where Bala came from. So he was Prince Devitt. He came from New Japan, and then Samoa Joe, that opened up. I knew about TNA, but then it opened up kind of like the classic TNA. So the stuff like AJ Styles, Christopher Daniels led back to Ring of Honor, which led to Kevin Steen, which then leads us kind of back to NXT, and it all just kind of goes full circle. It opens up different worlds.
Fairly, and it just, there's so many different kinds of styles. I mean, 2012 TNA is probably not the best example of wrestling, but at least it allowed you to go back and find your AJ Styles and what have you, because there was that 2000 to 2003 to 2000 and possibly 2008, 2009 period that was just unbelievable with everything, and the X Division was just red hot, and everything in between as well. So we had the pandemic. So you're a year and a half into training, and you're told you can't train anymore because everything's shut. Other stuff happens in between. So, and then you moved to GPWA to do one-to-one. So was there a particular reason why you chose GPWA? Was it just the fact that their trainers are so experienced, or was it just that was the opportunity and you wanted to get back into training again?
It was almost a mix of kind of all three of the factors. So for me, it's Glasgow's only 1 hour away on the train, and it's like one train, and I don't need to get off and move to other trains, and it's an easy walk from Central. Also, like you say, they've got really experienced trainers. At the time, it was BT Gunn, Steve Xavier, and Jack Jessler who were taking the one-to-ones. So they were great coaches to learn from. And the opportunity came up. I can't remember. My mum's seen it, that they were offering one-to-one sessions, and he had to be over 16, and I was close to turning 17 at this point. Oh, I remember August, so a couple of months away. But those three factors just led me to there.
Well, Stevie Xavier is probably perfect then, for what I'm gathering so far of what you're wanting to do and how you're trying to mold yourself. Stevie Xavier seems to be perfect to be able to push you in the right direction.
A lot of cool wee tips and tricks when I was training with him, just for like that kind of style, because he was used to say like, when he was kind of my age, he was same kind of build, kind of, you know, skinnier kind of guy who could like do kind of the acrobatic stuff. Learning from him was really, really good experience.
So then for my timeline I've got here, then you said around about August, then you'd started with GPWA and doing the one-to-ones. I've got your first match being August last year as well. So August 2020 started GPWA. Am I?
Yeah, and right? Then okay. August 2021 was... Well, so in like June 2021, I started with Respect. Then August, we did the wee, not charity show, I don't think it was. It was a wee kind of mini house show, like a showcase deal, I think it was.
Yeah, it was in their warehouse, wasn't it? So yeah. You had a match with Una Raw. So would this been your first match in front of a crowd?
Yeah.
Okay. So it's I think it's still on YouTube somewhere.
I watched it last night. Funny enough, I had a look at some of my matches. And I watched it last night and I was like, wow, that is... I don't really know what to think of it. I was like, oh, it's not the worst. Like, for a first match, it's not half bad.
Well, that was what I was going to lead on to. So, yeah, so you thought it was not bad. Was there anything now that you've wrestled Ewan again since then, but was there anything that you're feeling that first match when you were being told or when you're entering towards it, you're like, oh, God... working with the crowd, was that terrifying for you, or did you just switch off as soon as you went through the curtain?
So when you go through the curtain, I kind of switched off, and then the music stopped and I got in the ring, and that's when I was like, oh shit, there's a crowd there. Like, it's not just like the coaches and the other trainees, there's actual people here to see this. But we just kind of like did our thing, and it was all good fun. Like, Ewan's one of my favourite people to wrestle. Me and him have had a good couple matches, and whether it's been on the shows or in training, and it's always great fun to work with him.
Did you train with Ewan before when you were in PBW? Of course, that's where you initially came through. So at least when you're going to Respect, you've got that little bit of familiarity. You're not going through with like just fresh faces and you're not knowing anyone at all.
A couple of faces.
So that first match, then of course, Ewan being just a bundle of charisma, he's now wrestling just everywhere. He's popping up all over the UK and I think he's going to Denmark. I think by the time this comes out, he'll be would have wrestled in Denmark already.
This weekend he's away to Denmark. Or well, when this is out, the previous weekend we just had him in Denmark wrestling.
So you had your first match, quite happy with it at the time. I suppose when you go back and watch it now, you thought it was not bad, but I bet there was a bunch of stuff you went, I could do that better, I could do that better again. I want to do that, I want to try that a second time. So yeah, August 2021, first match in front of a crowd. How did you feel when you had to try and interact with a crowd then? I suppose with your training, your previous place that you trained, they're big into the whole hand claps and come on guys kind of thing. Was it just did you just fall into that trap straight away when it came to getting everyone going?
So many times I was kind of like told to try and get the crowd involved in a different way, and then almost immediately as the bell rings, I went right into the clapping and the come on guys. And watching it back, I was like, "Oh, Robbie, you fool! You fell for the trap. You got straight back in."
I think I've spoke to Stone Malone about it. At least you didn't fall into the trap of doing your entrance without a crowd. That's still pretty high tier. Just shenanigans of a highest order, which, I mean, it still makes me laugh to this day that they convinced them that was a good idea to train that way. So you had the first match. I think we've waxed lyrical so much about that, we can move on from that. So it was Respect Pro Wrestling Showcase. And the next one I've got noted was quite a bit later. So it was August 2021. And the first match I got noticed after that was February 2022. Positive that's wrong. Was there a match in between?
So I had a match in November on the Respect Pro Wrestling Return of the Lord show against Thomas Daniels.
Right. So obviously my research has failed. So Thomas Daniels, he's on our new face coming through Respect as well. I don't know if he's bouncing about other places for training. It might be now because Respect's closed. But so what was it like getting onto that first? So this is our first proper show for Respect, or your first main Respect show. So there'll be a crowd that aren't necessarily just full of friends and family. It's going to be people that have come to pay to see Paul Tracy and all that jazz. So what was it like being told, right, we've got the show coming up, Return of the Lord, big experienced Paul Tracy's on the show. We're putting you on with another inexperienced wrestler. What was your kind of thought process and being told that?
It was quite nerve-wracking, actually, because we were originally slated to be on, like, a pre-show type thing, so, like, an early doors. So, say doors were maybe, like, 6 o'clock. Our match would be on about 10 past, quarter past, and then the main show would kick off at the 1:30. But that got changed, and we got bumped up to the second last match. So, going out before the main event was quite nerve-wracking, because you had to kind of go out and do your thing. You didn't want to do too much because you want there's this big main event to go after. You don't want to like go and kill everyone dead. I just think going out and seeing like an actual crowd and just seeing unfamiliar faces, it's strange. I don't know how to describe it. You get an adrenaline rush going through the curtain. It's like you don't notice, but then you stop, you look about and you go, oh, holy shit, I'm actually doing this. This is really cool.
How'd you find going in front of a crowd of, what would you prefer actually? A crowd where you know people, friends and family or what have you, or do you prefer going out to a crowd where nobody knows who you are so you can dictate how they react to you? Because I mean, I suppose friends and family, they're all going to cheer for you anyway, but at least with a crowd that you don't know, they don't know you or you don't know them, there's a little bit of like a bit of a challenge, I suppose, that you've got to make sure you do your job right so they can react accordingly. Is that, which do you prefer?
Oh, I've been lucky enough and fortunate that my friends and family have been able to make it to all the shows I did for Respect.
Okay.
So I've not actually done one where I've not at least had like one or two folk there cheering me on. I don't know. I like doing it in front of my friends and family. There's something about, I like getting them to see, like, I think for a while it was just like, okay, Robbie likes wrestling, that's his thing, but like seeing me actually wrestle, I think they can understand why I really do love being a wrestler and like doing what I do.
Did you ever have a break? I mean, I suppose you've watched wrestling for what, 5 years, something like that. I was gonna say you wouldn't have a chance to have a break from watching wrestling, I suppose, at this point. So were you always the wrestling kid growing up then? Was it always Robbie likes wrestling, and then you just go, right, don't speak to him about wrestling because he'll just speak to you about
it will speak to you for hours. Do not ask the boy a thing about wrestling because he'll not shut up.
Yeah, still in that. I'm still at that stage at 31 as well. They try to very tiptoe around a wrestling subject, so otherwise I'm on them. I'm just like, but I know all this information. I need to tell you about all of it now.
Never grow out that stage. I don't think we get past that stage. It will always be with us somehow.
Oh yeah, you should. That's the way. I mean, wrestling, I suppose, online, and especially online, is like taken as quite serious, and you have to like this. You can't not like this. You can't and whatever. It's like, who cares? I like wrestling. Oh, wrestling's like, cool.
we all have different favorites.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's what makes it so unique. Everyone's got a different favorite. Everyone's got a different style, a different company, a different like brand. Some folk like really technical matches with lots of like really nice, crisp walk-ups and holds. Some folk like violent, bloody death matches. Like, there's something for everyone.
And some like Sin Cara and in his trampoline.
We liked him in his trampoline. We don't like. I don't. Does he still have the trampoline?
I have no idea. I don't know anything what Sin Cara's done after he left. And or they still have a trampoline when Hunico took over. The life and times of Sin Cara. I don't think he has his trampoline now, but maybe who knows? If Sin Cara's out there and wants,
I'll buy him a trampoline. I'll buy him a trampoline.
Robbie Cardwell will buy you a trampoline. I just want to know you're safe as well. That'd be nice.
Just we want to know if you're okay or not. We miss you.
Well, I mean, don't go that far. But so you had your match then. Well, of course, Paul Tracy being there, were you able to kind of pick his brain at all about your match, or was it a case of just wanted to get it done, and then your trainers will give you the feedback afterwards?
I never really got the chance to get a chat with Paul. I didn't get, like, they did a seminar the next day, but I was working I think I was working really early the next day. So I did the show, got home at like 12, got up, and I was at work for like 6 or something. So I never got the chance to go to the seminar, but then later on I watched the match back with like Bobby Roberts and DCT and Looking Sharp, and they all gave me good feedback and stuff about it and what to improve on. So a lot of it was just my movement and kind of crowd work was good. I was really energetic. I felt like I could go out and just like walk about that wee ring for about 20 minutes and just keep high-fiving folk. But I got some really constructive feedback off them, and I've been applying that to my matches as I go forward.
Certainly when it comes to crowd work, I mean, there's few better just in general. And I, anytime his name's mentioned, I always go on about him. But Looking Sharp especially, he knows his audience. He knows how to work an audience so well. DCT is also not bad at this as well. He can entertain a crowd, no bothering. Ask him Bobby Roberts. They've all got that kind of crowd pleasing and way of working a crowd. Because I think I said to someone else recently, I think it was London Lust yesterday as of recording, that wrestling gets to a point where if you're that good at wrestling, you don't need to actually do wrestling, because you can just entertain a crowd without actually doing anything with it. And those three guys especially, they've got it down. I watched a match recently with DCT live. I went to go see him live, and I honestly say I think he wrestled for about 10-15 minutes. I can only remember him taking maybe 2 bumps. That's it, because he didn't need to. He'd have the crowd in the palm of his hand the whole time. He didn't need to do anything. Maybe went to the corner and got beaten down. That was about it, really, because he didn't need to. Because that everyone just
like DCT.
Yeah, it's you got your bump card when you start wrestling. You don't want to fill it up too quickly, I suppose, at the end of the day. I mean, with your style or your intended style, it might get filled up a little bit quicker than others, but
mine's will be full by the end of the year. Like, I do stupid bumps. Like, that probably should not take at this age, because it's not going to do much well for me. But that's the style I like, and that's unique to me.
I mean, I suppose at your age as well, you'll bounce most of the time. It's when you hit your late 20s, early 30s, where once you're down, that's you for a good,
I know,
good 5 that, minutes.
I'll get that fear one day I'm going to do a dive and I'll just lie there. Like, oh, why did I do this? Like, I shouldn't have done it.
So got to fit. So after that, February 2022 is what I've got next year. I'm taking on Logan Lee and Benny, ML1, and then Raw again, April 2022. So you're getting these matches in. You're getting a bit more comfortable in the ring. How were you finding developing Robbie Cardwell, your look and that? Because of course you said you're wrestling jeans, which I find baffling. For me, it's even if it's skinny jeans, are still way restrictive to try and do anything with involving like lifting legs. That's maybe just I'm unfit. But so yeah, how are you putting together Robbie Cardwell as a character?
So it kind of like it came as almost just building on top of things I'm already kind of like. So the skateboard that comes from. If I was going out to like Iron Girders for training, I would get off at last because I don't have to skate out on my skateboard. Leather jacket, I've got, I wear my leather jacket everywhere. My bandanas, I've got like three on right now. The character was almost just like, let's take me and amp it up to a million.
That's always the best way, isn't it? That's what you hear. Best characters are the person ramped up to 11. We do have some questions about your skateboard and what have you, so we're gonna just dive into them. And we've got Emily Hayden just asking, see if you'll show us your epic skateboard design from the final Respect show.
I can. I have it right here because I've seen that and I'm like, I don't know what you're
talking about. This is for the video portion of the podcast. It'll be lost on audio listeners. Ah, Kirby. Yeah,
there we go.
Of course, it's Kirby. So when it comes to that, was that something you designed as well? Do you own skateboard spraying and what have you?
So the man that made this for me was Sean Martin, who won the Laird title at the last show in May, beat Frank Cross. He made this skateboard for me. We kind of talked. He's like, I was like, it'd be cool if we could do custom skateboards, and he's like. Give me a week later, he comes to me, he's bought the deck, and he's sending me, like pictures of, like, different fonts for my name, and stencils he's got for Kirby, and then, like, 2 weeks later, he sends me this, and we sat and built the skateboard after we put the ring up and stuff, and it took us about 2 hours to get all the trucks off, because they were rusted. Fuck.
He's a very talented man, is that Sean Martin?
He is, he's a very talented lad.
He also sent in a question, which
I've seen the question. I think when we gloss past this one, we don't need to answer it.
Well, I think we should still ask it. I'll just read it verbatim because I think that's probably the best way. Because for me having to change he's to use and all that would just make things confusing. So Sean Martin asks, why does he continue to disappoint me? Why won't he do a headlock? Why did I have to educate him about Super Dragon? Why won't he do a headlock? Ask him about how great I am. Ask him the difference between a pineapple and Martha Stewart. And finally, in capitals, why won't he do a headlock?
I did do a headlock. I had Kirby in a headlock on Sunday. That's question one answered.
I think that's question one, three, one of five, like, and seven answered yet.
There you go. difference between Martha Stewart and a pineapple. One's a pineapple, one's Martha Stewart. There you go.
We've already discussed how great he is, so that's that one covered.
We've ticked all his boxes. He's amazing. He's like honestly such. I'm so happy I met him at Respect. He's such a great friend.
Super Dragon, though. I mean, my only real taste of Super Dragon is Botchmania. Outside of that, I don't know much more about Super Dragon than that.
I didn't really know much about them. Yeah, I still don't. I haven't really properly looked into it yet.
He's gonna hear this.
I told Sean I did. I told Sean I watched all the matches and links that he sent me, but he sent me like six, and I was like, Sean, okay, I'll watch it. Wink. And sorry, Sean.
Shocking! Absolutely shocking. So we've got so we'll get into Martin Curry match. I think that's gonna be a good bulk of like. It's quite a big thing, and then we'll say we've got loads of other questions that we'll cover as well. You got a couple through the Instagram and what have you. Yes, I'm an age now where I call things the because I'm
the,
just,
yeah.
I'm just getting old. So Martin Kirby, when you were told, or when did you find out you're getting a match with Martin Kirby? Was it just when the graphic went up, or was there any rumblings beforehand that you were going to be in the ring with him?
So Bobby and Dee had told me a day. I can't remember if they told me before or after the February show. I have a feeling it was before the February show they told me, but it wasn't long before it. It might have been a week or two out from it. And then, like, when everyone else knew when the match graphic went up.
So, I mean, someone...
It was just quite surreal to be told, like, I was going to be wrestling somebody who is, like, probably one of the busiest wrestlers in the UK right now.
It's weird. I mean, I suppose when you started again, you said you went through these rabbit holes of TNA to Ring of Honor and all that kind of stuff. When it came to, did you study much about British wrestling and things like your Jody Fleisch, your Johnny Storm, like your Martin Kirby? Was there anything like that in your research prior to getting this match?
I'd never really studied British wrestling per se, but when I was younger, I used to watch like loads of What Culture. And they had WCPW, so that was kind of my introduction to Martin Kirby. So I went back and watched a couple of the matches they had down there. It was quite cool because, like, I was in high school when that was all happening, so I would have been, like, 14, 15. And now, like, fast forward a couple of years later, I've beaten. Like, I wrestled them and I beat them. Like, that's really cool.
Did you tell them that you watched them when you were in high school?
I did tell them.
How was he nice about it?
He was nice about it. He seemed quite chuffed.
Was that before or after the match? Because if it was, and if this it was before,
this was after.
Good choice.
I saved. I saved all this for after. I was like, right, professional before the match. We'll go backstage and we'll be nice and we'll just chat.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. He seems like a very calm person, but I suppose finding out that the person he's wrestling was in high school when they first found out, there might be a little bit of an extra sweetness to the chops and what have you.
So he was in high school. All right, there's going to be a bit extra mustard on these chops.
So yeah, and you beat him. So this is someone then, strangely enough, that you would have watched their rise in WCPW because it's not something I watched particularly, but I knew that he had this kind of little underdog story right up to being WCPW champion, had all the things with Adam Pacitti and Joe Hendry and all that kind of stuff. And so, yeah, so it must have been quite a cool thing, one, being in the ring with him, and two, pinning him.
Yeah. It was just really cool. Like, I don't really know what other way to describe it than for me. It's one of those, like, it's those moments you sit and go, like, what is actually going on? How have we gotten to where we are?
I've got a question accompanied to that from Emily Hayden, of course, who was part of Unity in respect. She just ask you how Martin Kirby was a dream matchup of yours. So I think we kind of covered it a little bit.
That was it, watching kind of him in WCPW to then actually wrestling him in respect on like the last respect show for me. It was quite like, I don't want to say fairy tale moment because that's quite overused, but it was almost like a wee kind of moment. So went from watching him to that's my last match in respect. I don't think there's any better match I could have went out on.
Kind of like your graduation kind of thing, and now you're allowed to expand to the world.
It's come full circle.
So we've got Ruby Roberts asking, if you had to choose your ultimate intro tune for yourself, what would it be?
So, I don't know, actually. If I could just use any like song... A song that I love, and it's a cover. It's Sad But True. It's Royal Blood did a cover for Metallica for their Black Label album. But if I could just steal a wrestler's theme song, it'd be AJ Styles' Demigod. Because watching him come out to like that song at War of the Worlds is untouchable. Like him with the IWGP title, you get Gallows and Anderson with the tag belts, the Young Bucks with the junior tag belts. Like, genuinely was like God had just entered the room.
It's literally the only one I probably don't know of because I'm a big TNA kid anyway. So I know all these TNA ones, so, and then his WWE one, which is a bit weird, but it's grown on me. I've gotten used to it. But no, his New Japan stuff is just absolutely foreign to me.
I love it.
Pardon the pun. I don't know. I've just never gravitated towards New Japan. And everyone says it's awesome, it's amazing, it's excellent, and all that kind of stuff. It's just just never it's never been on my radar enough for me to continue watching it. I like convenience. I don't find it's convenient to watch, so it just doesn't get there. I know
sometimes it is like you need to look for, you need to go through YouTube for ages. You'll find one, but like the commentary's in Japanese, but you'll still watch it. But then you're like, I kind of wish it was English.
Like, you find going back and watching those now, you've actually had a couple matches and done some of the wrestling. Do you go back and watch it with a different kind of mindset now? Do you go back and watch it a bit more critically? You can look at it, oh, look at his footwork, look at this, look at that, or are you still able to switch off and just watch it as it's presented to you?
It's a wee bit of both. Sometimes if a match is really good, then it properly gets going. It switches off. But if there's a match and you're sitting and it's quite slow, like even on WWE, if you're sitting watching a pay per view and the match is quite slow and there's not really much happening, you do get a wee bit bored and you're like, oh, it'd be cool if they did this, or like, why has he done this? That doesn't make sense. But if the match really gets you invested, your brain does just switch off. You can just enjoy it.
You can go back afterwards and someone will go, oh, did you notice this? You go, no, I just saw an RKO and it was amazing.
I just seen Randy on RKO, Chad Gable doing a backflip, and I was like, that's cool.
Speaking of that kind of stuff, I suppose then Ian Skinner's asked, can you do a kickflip?
Very sorry to disappoint Mr. Skinner, but I cannot do a kickflip.
Is this a skateboard maneuver?
Yes.
How old do I sound? Yeah, so what's your skateboard prowess then? Is it just doing...
Just cruising about, going as fast as I can.
No grinding and ollies?
No, ankles have been snapped, shins have been bruised in the attempt. So that's why I don't do it anymore.
Benny's asked, speaking of that, Benny's asked, who did you main in Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2? And what's your favourite tune from the soundtrack?
So I never played Tony Hawk Pro Skater 2. I was more of a Skate 3 kind of guy, like the knockoff version on the Xbox that you got for free.
Right. So, well, Benny, we can't answer that question. So I don't know any of the tunes, sir.
Yeah. Sorry, Benny. I'll play the game if that helps, and listen to the sound.
It'll go in the pile with Sean Martin's Super Dragon matches. It'll eventually get down to it.
I'll listen to Benny. I'll just not watch it just to wind Sean up. So I'll just do it out of spite just to wind him up.
Yeah, I think Tony Hawk's, the really way I played it was on a demo disc for the PS1. That's probably as close as I came to it way back when. And I would just, I didn't know buttons. I just like ran and did some ollies and then hope I didn't fall off and then do it again.
Tried to get the biggest score you could.
That's my gaming style. Full stop. It's just hope for the best and just hit all the buttons. We've got Judas Gray. He just says he challenges you to a ladder match. Do you accept?
I do accept. I accept.
Fair enough. Have you come into contact with Judas Gray through Respect or through Edinburgh or GPWA or wherever?
So first met Judas Gray at the Respect show in February. He had a match with Awesome Rob. It was awesome. And then I met him again up at the FPWA Mark Andrews seminar. We attended that. And he was at the Martin Cowboy seminar on Sunday, and it was lovely to see him.
So speaking of someone, again, we're going through, like you said, Stevie Boy being perfect for your kind of style. Mark Andrews obviously be another one coming through. Of course, NXT UK, he's done TNA, he's wrestled everywhere. Was he a guy that, I don't know, did he impart like an extra bit of wisdom for how to deal with that high risk style? Was there anything that you took away from it that you may have thought, oh, never thought of that kind of thing with Mark Andrews?
He showed quite like a lot of really good, like you can do really high flying pin combinations, which was really quite nice to learn because like it's just flashier ways to transition into things. So rather than just like doing a growing up inside to give him a schoolboy, there's so much more fun ways you can transition yourself and like ways to move yourself in the air, if that kind of makes sense. I don't really know. He was definitely like, I've seen that seminar advertised and I was like, right, I am like perfect to go and just sponge off somebody who's got a wealth of high flying.
When you mentioned like moving your body in that in the air, do you do anything to kind of help with that? Like I know likes of Lucha DS, they go to, he goes to trampoline parks and does all that kind of stuff. Is that something that you do as well, or is there anything that you do to kind of try and be able to control your body in the air a bit more?
I probably should go to trampoline parks. A lot of the times it was just like, I'll just try something in training, and if it works, it works, and kind of build on it. So like, if I'm doing like a springboard missile drop kick, rather than just like not getting, I used to kind of just dive at my opponent legs first, but now I've been able to like turn my body, I can shoot myself a wee bit higher up and get more of a spring. And it's just kind of practicing your moves. Like, if you do a move enough, you can really get it nice and crisp.
So I've got a couple of random questions. We've got Stone Malone, as mentioned already. You just ask what your favourite McFlurry is. That's his favourite question that he likes to ask people.
Favourite McFlurry is the... It's not available anymore, so I'm actually really upset about this. McDonald's was doing... What were they called? Cadbury's Cream Egg. It was the Easter special. It was the Cream Egg McFlurries. They were phenomenal.
Oh, no, too sweet for me. That's just my...
Oh, it's delicious. Like, I don't know how I ate an unhealthy amount of those. And I'm proud of it.
Give me a Smarties any day. That's my go-to. Classic. Nice classic.
Never had one.
Just unbelievable. So also got through the Instagram. Now, the Instagram ones, I don't have who asked the questions. So I'll just ask them anyway. So if you did ask them through Instagram to Robbie directly, thank you. And you can take credit even if it wasn't yours, I don't know. So you can take credit if you want. So speaking on the food front, we already talked about the McFlurry. I think the most obvious one to go with afterwards is, what's your go-to meal deal?
Morrison's cheese ham sandwich, packet crisps, and a can of Monster. That's
what you do, because I meal deals around here is Tesco or Asda's crap, though. Asda's is buy three, the third one's the cheapest is free. That's not a meal deal. That's 3 for 2. But the Tesco one, you always go for the massive Red Bull, because it's £3. I think it's £3.50 now, the meal deal in Tesco, and your big Monster's £2.39 right off the bat. You're a pound. You're only got a pound left.
You're Red Bull, pretty much. Yeah. And you get a sandwich and something else.
Exactly. You've always got to take advantage of the meal deal. That's why it's there. And that's probably why it's went up 50p in the last year or so, because everyone's going in going, right, I'll just get the Monster, get the most expensive sandwich. It's always the 3-1. You get the 3 bacon and whatever. So you get like a tuna, a sandwich and a half, and you pick the most expensive sweet as well, because, you know, why not? That's just the way the meal deal works. So if anyone says otherwise, I was just glad you didn't say anything like water, which is such a useless thing to put into a meal deal.
Only time I'll ever get a meal deal for water is if I've already got Monster on me, which is like it's anyone's game. Sometimes I've got like 3 cans, sometimes I've got none.
So have you got a particular favorite flavor of Monster, or is it just wherever you get
this one? The white one.
Ultra was my go-to right about the start of pandemic, when I was watching the pay-per-views or premium live events every month. And I was like, right, I'll get one of those every time. But can you wait off them? Like, well, last time I had Lucozade do energy drinks now, and they just don't make me want to have a heart attack afterwards. So they're kind of a little bit better, I suppose. But you're young. Heart attacks, they're going to reach you just yet. Come back to me in 10 years. If you're still drinking Monster, then probably a different matter.
I try not to drink as many nowadays, but I still drink probably a wee bit more than I should.
I think Ian Skinner might be a guy to tap. He's got these like protein energy drinks that aren't as bad for you or something like that. It's supposed to taste nice. I remember when I spoke to him for his second appearance, which was just a very interesting episode. The one of the questions was about Monster, and he said, I don't drink it anymore, and he went through all this stuff that he's got that's like good for you, but still energy drinks. So just putting out there.
Like the powdered energy drink stuff you put in water. Yeah, Sneak Energy. I've seen him playing about with those on Instagram before. And I've seen him buy them, and they said they were really good. So I was like, right, I'll try this. Now I've got like three tubs of it sitting behind my laptop.
And yet you've still got a monster in front of you.
Yep. Yep.
So we've got more questions in. Loads. It's great. It's always like when there's loads of questions in. I was quite
shocked when I seen I got a lot of questions. I was like, oh, this is quite nice. People want to ask me what I think.
It's a worry when I've got a guest that no questions come in, which is not unusual. No questions come in. I've only got like three lines of notes thinking, oh, how are we going to fill this time here? Most of the time it works. We're fine. I usually just like go to a fail safe of what kind of cartoons do you like?
Asking folk what their favourite Sin Cara match is, because that's a real topic. That's a really good one.
What is your favourite Sin Cara match?
I don't know. I don't think I have
all of them.
All of them. They're all the same match. So you love them all.
The one where he botched, or the one where he broke his finger.
The one where he broke his finger and called the match off.
That was
an interesting one. I feel I'm allowed to make fun of him for that, because I actually popped my thumb out of place during my match in February, and I still did it. I bumped, popped it out, and then when I did the super kick, I popped it back in.
Oh, no.
God. That was vile. And I felt that, like, I slapped and then pop, and I was like, oh, fuck.
But you carried on. So I mean, if we're going through that as our score sheet here, it's Robbie Cardwell 1, Sin Cara 0.
Yeah,
to continue matches with broken fingers. Oh, so that's just going through my head now. Right. Okay. So we've got another question through Instagram. What are your goals for the next year? And how do you plan to achieve them?
I want to wrestle for as many promotions and companies as I can. I want to wrestle. Basically, like, my goal and dream is just to wrestle everywhere. I want to wrestle all over the world, many different countries, cities, whatever. Like, just, I want to wrestle everyone. That is the broad goal.
Excellent. I think we've got a quite similar question as well, which is, where is it? Westy. Actually, no, it's not similar at all. Who's your ideal dream wrestling opponent?
AJ Styles. Like, I don't think there's ever been anyone better to lace up a pair of boots.
Would he come out to his New Japan theme as well? Would that be a request you'd make?
I would ask if he would come out to Demigod just for me as a one-time thing. Like, that would, yeah, perfect.
Excellent. Back to Instagram, what's been your biggest challenge so far in wrestling?
Over lockdown, trying to find a new home after everything kind of shut down. It was trying to find, right, what's next and how am I going to continue with wrestling? That was probably the biggest challenge.
I suppose it's weird. I mean, at the time, of course, some people went back and went back to that particular place as well. But yeah, there was quite an influx of wrestlers just popping up in other schools. Like, it was weird seeing like the results for Source Wrestling recently, and it's like, oh, there's a lot of guys that came from that place kind of appearing here now, and you see Respect, their last show, and I recognize those from Academy Attack shows and the like as well. So it is strange just seeing people. I mean, I suppose it's great for yourself and for other wrestlers as well that they're able to find new environments and different kind of training styles, and because one might be a bit more technical based, one might be a bit more focused on like high flying or showmanship, I suppose, as well. So it's always good to find new places.
Probably what made me into like kind of like style I've got now and how I wrestle. Like, so at JPWA, I'm part of like BT Gunn's class. So when from like him, Bobby Roberts, DCT, Luke King Sharp is mentioned as well. Like, kind of learning mixed styles from the four of them. And then, like, somebody like Wolfgang, if I was ever down at Iron Girders, or like Stevie or Jack Jester, learning from like some of the really great coaches in the UK, I think it really benefits you. I think it's good to branch out and learn from as many people as possible, because even if it is just one or two things you pick up from learning from one person, still one or two more things that make you into a better wrestler.
Oh, yeah, I mean, I always use this cliche for every most chats anyway now, it's the puzzle. You've got your puzzle, yeah. And every place you go gives you another piece to that puzzle that creates you as your full picture kind of thing. And yeah, that exactly, yeah. Yeah, makes sense. go to different places and you get an extra puzzle piece. During the lockdown, you said you started one-to-ones as well. Did you do anything online, like the FPWA stuff or the Looking Sharp Dojo series?
Yes, the Looking Sharp Dojo of Excellence online. That is, I did a couple of those. They were good fun.
There's plenty, again, going through what I think your style would be. There's like Mickey Whipwreck and but just incredible as well, I suppose. And yeah, there was plenty of people there that kind of could help mold what you're going for Robbie Cardwell as well. But yeah, was there anyone in particular that you were surprised about that you were like, oh, I didn't think I would take as much from that than I did?
I don't know. Like, they were kind of a while ago. I think the Mikey Whipwreck and Just Incredible ones, like Mikey Whipwreck was one of the greatest underdogs in ECW. So kind of learning a lot from him. That was really good.
Excellent. And we've got last question on the Instagram, which I think we've kind of covered round about the start, but I'll just ask it anyway. What inspired you to be a wrestler and who was your idol?
Again, just like watching wrestling growing up, my idol is not Sin Cara. I don't know who I would say my definitive idol is. Like, there's one wrestler I look at and go, oh, I'm going to like love this person forever. This is like my absolute favorite wrestler. It changes. It really changes like the weather.
That's absolutely fair. It's like right about the start of lockdown, of course, when everyone was trying to find things to do, and it was share your top five favorite wrestlers. And I was like, today is these five. Ask me tomorrow, I'll probably have another four different answers. And like Jeff Hardy was always the constant, but the other four, Kurt Angle might go in a day. I might be just in the mood for a better Kurt Angle. So he was in there. And then next day, I was like, nope, I'm definitely in a Steve Austin mood. That's what's going in the top five today. It's just, yeah, it's we're spoilt for choice, I suppose, when it comes to the sources and the resources and the amount of wrestling we can watch nowadays when it's literally at our fingertips. And it could be a wrestler out there that you've never seen that as soon as you see them, he's your new favorite as well. So it's amazing. Because I think Leo McLean recommended Vikingo, I think, and I was watching some of his stuff through AAA, and I was like, oh my God, this guy looks amazing. He does all the flips and he looks like a Viking. What's not to love about this? Exactly. So favorites can change every day. Before we go into what's coming up, because I think it's very important we talk about what's coming up because what's already just happened as well, because we made a debut just casually on the WWE Network. So we'll get to that in a second. We've got our two questions that we ask everyone. Totally silly, stupid questions. Don't need to think about it too hard unless you really want to. First up, what's your favorite dinosaur?
T-Rex. They're big, they're scary, and yeah.
Nice classic. And what would win the fight, two sheep or one cow?
One cow. I feel like one sheep would maybe get... It's like one sheep would get scared and the cow would just beat up the other sheep.
Fair enough. I like the logic put behind it. So yeah, recently I was watching, I was sat down ready to get my results ready for WWE Network ICW Fight Club, just casually doing that. Jason Reed had a match. Cool, that's fine. Quick match. And then he challenged anyone else to come out. And who may appear?
It was me. I appeared. I answered his challenge. And then got my arse handed to him.
I mean, we didn't mention that bit, but still, I was going through the match. I was like, that's a bit weird. Jason Reed's got two matches in a row, and then obviously it made sense watching it. Why? But yeah, ICW debut in the asylum, in front of an ICW crowd, which can be either the scariest place on earth, or I find that at the moment some of the asylum shows they're a bit quiet, but some of them they can be just absolutely raucous and crazy. On the WWE Network, yeah. How were you put forward for that? How did it come about?
It was really last minute. BT Gunn had put me forward for it. It totally just came out of nowhere. It was like, we've got a spot open. Do you want it? And I was like, yeah, I'm there. It was as simple as that. It was like, you've been put forward for a spot this weekend. Do you want it? Yeah, take it.
What was it like then wrestling in front of an ICW crowd? Even though, like you say, it was just mostly Jason Reed beating you up. But still, it's still an ICW crowd. What was it like?
I slapped him. Like, And it was a metal brace. There was a bit of metal in my hand as well at the times. I had my brace on for popping my thumb out of place. So that did some damage to him. I don't know, they were really nice. They knew my name, which I was a bit shocked about. I got a Robbie chant. Like, and I was like, how do you people know who I am? Like, why do you know my name?
And now,
yeah, they were all really nice.
And now you can search your name on WWE Network, I assume, and you're next to like big names like Highlander Robbie. And I can't think of any other more Robbies. Robert Stone.
There we go.
You know, yeah. Robert Roode. There we go.
Yeah, here we go. Close enough.
So when it came out then, because of course I don't find out the results of ICW when they happen, because I did once and people weren't happy about it. I did that. So I don't get the spoilers anymore. I find out when the shows go out themselves. So did you keep it a secret that you were going to be on the WWE Network, or were you just telling everyone to watch ICW Fight Club this particular weekend because, your sales turning up on it?
I think I told a couple of I told one or two folk that I was doing it. Like, I got a text on, like, Thursday about it, and I did the taping on the Sunday. And I went out the Sunday night with my friends, and he was like, oh, what time do you want to meet me? I was like, well, I need to do this, like, Fight Club taping, and then I'll come and meet you after. But then it did kind of just turn into, oh, watch ICW Fight Club this weekend. I might be there. But then I kept getting my dates mixed up because I forget that everything airs like 2 weeks on delay. Mm-hmm. So I kept checking every weekend, like, why, where am I? Where's my tiny wee, like, 30 seconds? Really looking forward to it. And I kept forgetting that they're on like a 2 week tape delay.
I mean, you still got a segment on the actual list as well.
I thought it was. I looked at like the actual list, like for the segments, and it had like Jason Reed versus Robbie Cardwell, and I was like, that's quite cool.
That's being screenshot and then shared to everyone in the group chats. Going, look at me, $9.99. Go sign up.
WWE Network superstar now. That's me.
I mean, you can put it in your bio. It's not wrong.
It's not technically wrong.
Exactly. It's yeah. Technically, I mean. I appeared in the Thunderdome. I don't think I can still count myself as being on the network, but you definitely can. You've actually done wrestling on the WWE Network, so I think it's safe to say you can say Robbie Cardwell WWE the new Twitter handle if you so wish.
Robbie Cardwell WWE.
Yeah, that's it. Sorted. So that's the social media plug sorted. It's not for anyone listening.
It's like generic. It's like my name then a number at the end of it.
And then, of course, that leads on to your GPWA debut.
Yes, match.
And, you know, so you had their WWE Network against Jason Reed for ICW Fight Club. Upcoming match for GPWA, you're just in the ring with ICW World Heavyweight Champion Kez Evans.
Yes.
So that's quite a big match to have and to get.
Yeah, I'm quite nervous for this one. I'm very excited.
So Kez, of course, he started one of the first or second classes intakes of GPWA, and now you've come in at the most kind of recent-ish ones as well. So it's like the bookend of GPWA. As someone who's obviously he's got plenty of footage now through the WWE Network and YouTube and what have you, his style's quite a bit different. It's like it's going to be very much chalk and cheese kind of thing. He's more of a ground and choke you out kind of thing.
Yeah, like kind of ground and pound.
So is there any kind of matches that you kind of watch to get inspiration how to deal with that? I suppose Kez has had matches with the likes of your Talon Juniors and your Daz Blacks and what have you, and Craig Anthony's that kind of have the similar style-ish.
That's probably one of my best kind of go-tos for looking at how to take down somebody like Kez. Because like it's almost we are polar opposites in style. Like wrestling Martin Kirby, he's still very agile. He isn't like a total brawler, but Kez is like a really big, heavy kind of brawler. He is going to like actually kill me, maybe. Hopefully not.
I mean, I suppose it's not impossible. I mean, it could be one of your classics, Big Show Rey Mysterio matches, or it could end up being Sheamus Sin Cara. We don't know. There's two.
Don't know. It's either going to be the biggest upset, or it's going to be the death of the little emo flippy kid.
Maybe we'll find out. I don't have the date in front of me. Hang on, I'll find out though, because if it's going to go on after this comes out, it makes sense to plug it properly. So I'm just going to.
I think it goes. I think it's Sunday.
So swscotland.com. It is May 22nd at the Asylum in Glasgow. Kez Evans goes one-on-one with Robbie Cardwell. Only match announced as of recording. No, it's not. There's two matches announced as of recording.
Two matches. There's one more.
There's Ravy Davey, Leon Graves. I think there's our one. So 2 p.m. Nice afternoon shift. 2 p.m. Doors open. 2:30 bell time. I think it's still available. So yeah, you're coming in. Coming hot and wrestling experience Scotland. Afternoon at the Asylum against the World Heavyweight Champion and Kez Evans. I think he was on the PWI last year as well. So that's pretty good to be in with them.
I know, I've done quite well here.
I know. I mean, it's still quite a decent track. If your last two matches at this point would be Kez Evans, Martin Kirby, and then prior to that would be you and a Raw. We said he's wrestling everywhere now.
He's wrestling everywhere now.
And then Logan Lee and a guy called Benny. Yeah, there's plenty.
Benny, good. No last name.
Benny, no last. Yeah, he was Big Benny when I first talked to him, and I was just Benny.
It's still Big Benny on Twitter, I think, but I think he's dropped the big and he's now just Benny.
He's now put Benny in capitals, so I suppose technically it's still Big Benny. When it comes down to if you're technically being correct, which is the best kind of correct. So looking to the future, then, you've already mentioned that you just want to wrestle everyone everywhere. But is there any particular promotions that you want to get into, whether it's Progress, Discovery, whatever? Is there any particular companies that you're like, I need to wrestle there as soon as possible?
I guess in the UK, it is really the bigger companies. I want to get out there. I want to kind of put my name out there and show that I am one of the best young ladies. I want to go to companies like GCW because, I don't know, it's death matches to me. I want to do death matches. I know a lot of folk wince at the thought of doing thumbtacks and glass and light tubes. I'm just fuck it, might as well. To me, it looks fun. That's probably not the.
If you do it once, I suppose there's yeah, you get at least done the once. If it's new for you, at least you've tried it.
Yeah. In the UK, I just want to wrestle for everyone. I genuinely just want to, wrestling makes me, really enjoy the job. So I want to just wrestle everywhere. I want to wrestle everyone, and folk through wrestling as well. And sometimes you see folk you've not seen for ages, and it's always nice to catch up with folk. It's me. I love wrestling. I love it.
That's fine. So we'll go to the last question and do your social media because the internet is starting to die again. So we'll try and we'll wrap this up before it actually totally, just totally cuts out. So last question that we ask people is a fancy booking. It's a fancy booking question that I think you kind of answered, but I'll give you a crack at it. Vince McMahon or whoever, Tony Khan, whoever runs New Japan, they've given you a phone and you get their main event slot, their biggest show of the year. You get to choose your opponent or opponents. You get to choose a match stipulation as well. And my only kind of stipulation add to that is they must be alive. Who would you be in the ring with? So it could be anything. It could be triple threat. It could be tag team. It could be rumble. It could be anything you want. The possibilities are endless. What would the match be?
Much as I love the straight singles with AJ, I would love to wrestle Darby Allin. Give me Darby in a death match. There you go. Darby Allin in a death match. That's it.
I wasn't expecting that when we started chatting, but the more you went on, I'm just absolutely. That makes the most sense in the world. Just 2 years, just doing absolutely nuts things in the main event of whatever, WrestleMania, Double or Nothing.
Double or Nothing.
Excellent. So before we go then, where can people find out about Robbie Cardwell on the social medias?
So, as far as I think, my Twitter is Robbie Cardwell 1, capital R, capital C. Twitter, I'm not really on. I've only started using my Twitter. Instagram, you can find me at Robbie_C0212. I'm quite active on there as well. I don't have a Facebook. Should probably make a Facebook.
Just because it cut out, the Twitter is at Robbie Cardwell 1, if anyone's wanting to go check that out. But perfect. Well, I think we're getting out now before the internet absolutely dies. But thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me. And we'll see how you get on with Kez Evans at the end of the month.
I really enjoyed it.
Excellent. Have a good one.